Yeah, I just subscribe fully. So, no, I think it's a great point. I think connecting the conversations is the most prolific way in which we can try and find an insurgent and insurgently critical vocabulary for our interests and goals. And I was also thinking that the reflections emerging in the critical race conversations in Europe are very, very good and prolific. I was in Amsterdam 2 months ago in a workshop with Gloria Becker and Philomena Essen, and the amount of interesting ideas circulating was overwhelming, obviously. But some of the points that were coming out from papers about the refugee crisis and about evictions of Calais, for example. I mean, some of the ways new ideas trying to be circulated or produced is this historical global perspective that connecting the colonial past to the post-colonial present it was very prominent at least there. So this historical lens, I think, is particularly interesting. But also, for example, really new theories of racism, because we all know that racism is not something that is once conceptualized and that's all. It's always changing and needs to be reframed as society is changing. So, for example, Philomena Essen came out with this concept, entitlement racism, 4 years ago, and I think she's also continuously to develop it, which I think is a nice description of this sense of feeling entitled to discriminate, to exclude, etc., on the basis of race and ethnicity, etc. So, which is overwhelmingly present in Europe if we think about white nationalists or white supremacists.
Thank you. So I guess at this point I would like to open the floor to questions, comments for either of our speakers, or also to me, of course. Or I don't know if you would, if you liked either Noah or Giovanni to flesh out some of the arguments or examples in their books. You can also do so. Do you want to pass the books around at this point so that we can hear it? The floor is open to questions, comments, observations. And my students are also very welcome. You get 5 more ECTS points.
Very specifically, and probably in the interest of time, about the economic pressures that contributed to government policies. But I have to remember in the 60s that in America that many, many cities, large and small, underwent what was called urban renewal. Mm-hmm. And I think it was maybe the head of Congress of Racial Equality or something who said, we know that urban renewal means Negro removal, and it was indeed because in almost all these cities there was a very healthy black commercial center that was working well and invited a lot of envy, and that's part of the reason that these entire communities were relocated with the highway funding that brought a highway in between the two parts of town. So it's a very, and then later I think of NAFTA with the Straßenhandel, because during the period of discussion on NAFTA that there were American businessmen who talked about cleaning up the Mexican economy, which basically meant moving out the Straßenhandel and moving in the fast food chain. So I just wonder about the economic pressures that you reflected on in your book.
Yeah.
you are more focused on this specific
I'm wondering whether the economic pressure is the right term to get a head around, because if you look at politics of urban renewal, you have the logic of civilization, a civilizing mission in there, and how do you measure economic pressure? Like, as you said, like, there were like healthy black neighborhoods, so why is there an interest to destroy, relocate, and whatever? And I think that the economic measurement as such is so much focusing on specific needs and specific interests that it doesn't really reflect like who is affected by that. And actually it's referring back to what Giovanni was saying, that the organizing principle is raised, but it's detached, and what urban planning is about is so much to create a modern city, and it's detaching the organizing principle of race, but we refer to what we understand as modernity, and that's why my profession is about architecture. It's rendering what the modern city and the future city look like, and it's not really about the people and so on, but how specific spaces should look like and who is interested should be served and so on. And then you have this whole argument about global competition and so on. But to think of modernity and coloniality together, then you start thinking, but who are the people, who are the neighborhoods, who are the ones being relocated and so on. But if we have a one-sided discussion within urban development, you didn't grasp it all. And so that's, I think it's also an ethical question towards what urban planning is about.
Definitely, but the pressures brought to bear on these bodies, like urban planning bodies, you think that that's
what?
Not, I mean, I guess I just don't quite understand. Are you saying that the pressures brought to bear on these kinds of urban planning bodies are really secondary, and that the structure of racism is the primary mover in this case, or that they don't work together?
I think it's not a primary or a secondary, they go in conjunction.
Yeah. Okay.
But if you don't talk about the conjunction, you have like this magic, and you cannot really critically re-engage and problematize these whole processes of modernization, because it seems to serve everybody, but at the end it doesn't serve. But I think what we are interested in is to think of those processes in conjunction, and they inform each other.
Yeah, if I just can add one little thing. I think the conjunction can be named partially political economy. So one thing is political economy.
Yeah.
One thing is economic pressure. Another thing is racist conceptions and ideologies. What connects the two is the choice of the elites.
Yeah.
How do you organize urban renewal? You have options. So the ways in which you think about the populations affected by your urban renewal is determined, and determines and drives your choices, and drives your political choices. And that's where I think the conjunction happens.
Just one
for that.
Yeah, I have a question that follows on from that exact point, which is, where do you see the role model of cities or communities or organizations in rethinking urban renewal? So a lot of the story that I took away from both of the talks was kind of the negative impact of how cities are developing. But are there really positive cities and positive examples of decolonization or urban renewal in Europe dealing with colonial?
So you're asking for good examples.
Yeah, well, so one example in Berlin, I know, is this kind of movement to rename streets, and there's some controversy over whether or not that is the right way to do it. So I was interested in your views on specific examples.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, like in that book which you're referring to, there is an article of me in there, and I was thinking about what would it mean to decolonize the city? And I think part of the process could be, or part of the process of decolonization could be forms of renaming could be undoing the Humboldt Forum. I mean, we're just building it up. I think like in 20 years it could be gone. Why not? And all these things, and we have to just, I don't know, what are we going to do with these ethnological collections and the museums? I mean, why do we need them to have in Europe? And so on. There are many, many questions. But if we understand the particular, the European Western city as a device for, on one hand, a colonial endeavor and a neoliberal, then I'm actually wondering, is the city as such the vehicle to think of a process of decolonization? So it's kind of, do we really need the city? And I think that's kind of, so I think there are many, many models and activities, but it's hard to say that there is this one city which is showing what it could be about. Because actually at the end we have to think about cohabitation and our responsibility and whatever. Like, is that really about living in an urban environment and so on?
Yeah, so thanks for the question. It's, I tend to think in the same way. So what is the city? Is the city the built environment, or the city is what the citizens do, or what the citizens make of urban space, institutions, and so on? And I think the second definition is more in the line of social science, urbanists or urban scholars, urban studies. And and I'm thinking about the city as a practice. So you make the city, it's not that the city exists, but we make the city together. And so at the end of the book, in the last chapter, I do point at, you know, race conscious examples of urbanism, and which are, you know, driving away from the magical property of racelessness. And one of them is exactly what you mentioned, the struggle to rename the streets. And the same, you know, collective, which is advocating for renaming the streets, organizes streets, city tours in the African neighborhood and in the